Welcome to Joy Fiddle International. Today we're going to be bringing you something really exciting, as we always do. And what does Joy Fiddle International stand for? It's all about inspiring you to success. Now, we know we do talk to some people out there because of the responses we receive. We love to support people, we love to encourage people, we love to be there for people. And we get responses back, you know, telling us, giving them a message that they were not thinking about. And something has made them think, you know, inspired something in them. And that really gives us so much energy and excitement to come back with more. Because funny enough, the more you share, the more you receive. And most times when I come here to share messages with you, it's not just for you, it's for me as well. But the message does come to me, so when it does, I need to share it. And like I said, when I share it, I receive as well. And so we are receiving the same messages at the same time. So today I'm bringing really something that's really touching, something that's deep in my core, deep in who I am. My name is Joy Fiddle, and we'll be having a very, I don't know if I should call it serious or beautiful or wonderful chat today. So welcome on board. Okay, so Joy Fiddle International is about inspiring you to success. But out of Joy Fiddle International, I did come up with something that I really love to deal with. And I love to call it Joy Fiddle Africa. Africa, because that's where I come from. And there's so much going on in Africa that I'm really, really touched. I'm touched about it. And I feel it will be a travesty if, with all the things I know about life, and I see so much going on, and then I pretend like it's not happening, or I carry on with a regular life thinking I'm achieving something. So Joy Fiddle Africa here is really to uplift the mindset of us Africans, uplifting the mindset of Africans, because it is that time in life when you either be part of what's going on or you be against it. There's really no standing in, how do they say, on the fence, where you're neither here nor there. And for somebody like me, who is very vocal, because I believe God gave me a voice for a reason to use it. So when I see something that isn't right, I have no other choice but to speak about it. So Joy Fiddle Africa is definitely here to stay, because there's a lot going on in my continent, Africa, that really should not be going on. And today I'm coming to you from a city called Port Harcourt, and that's actually the very place where I'm from, Port Harcourt in Nigeria. And I'm going to be in Nigeria for some time, but I'm studying here in Port Harcourt. And what's been interesting is so much information coming in and out. People who live here locally have so much to talk about going on. But as an African, what can I possibly do about it? And that's what today's chat is going to be about. It's about how we can create a greater Africa. And I call it for the greater good of Africa. That's what the title of today's chat is about, for the greater good of Africa. So you know this saying, Rome wasn't built in a day. A journey of 1,000 miles starts with one step. Something about, if you want to predict the future, you start with a change. And that's where this is about. If we want to create a greater Africa, we need to do something as Africans. And so much is happening right now in the world that actually does give you a really clear message that something needs to be done. I was chatting with someone the other day, and I did say to her, yes, as a child, I grew up knowing Africa as the giant in the sun. That's what it was called, the giant in the sun. But today we're being called the dark continent. And why is that? How things have changed. Right now, look at the world. In the UK, where I live, we have what they call the Brexit. Brexit vote, UK wanting to go it alone, UK wanting to be out of the European Union and want to face the world themselves. And in the US, we now have this vote for Donald Trump, which was a huge shock to everyone, but it's happened. And there's a big sweep going around the world now called nationalism. People are all trying to look inwards and see what they can create from what they have. And then my question then to us Africans is then, what is going on with us? What are we looking at? We're looking at 54 countries that make up what we call Africa, with a billion people and more. And yet we're being seen as the dark continent. What is wrong with our way of thinking? That's what I want to find out. Why? What are we doing that's causing that? Because everyone is moving forward in the world. I mean, continents across this world are moving forward. Great things are happening. I came from China recently, and something as amazing as the trolley you push your luggage on has a TV screen on it where people are actually watching a movie while just sitting down and waiting for their flight to be announced, or the movement of the flight being, you know, you could actually just look on the screen and you see it on your push, on your trolley with your little, you know, cabin luggage in there. You're just sitting down there relaxing, and there you are watching a movie while you're waiting for your plane. And these are the kind of technology and development that's going on in the world and really touching. Inside the plane that I traveled with, the temperature was auto-controlled. There was no window. You know, when you get into the window seat in the plane and you have to flip the window open or shut it. This wasn't the case. It was auto-controlled. I actually took a picture of it because it was so amazing. The minute the sun came, the window knew what to do. And what, you know, these are the things going on in the world. And we are still here in Africa, all looking for the next plane to take us away from our continent, away from all the amazing resources that God had put in our control. And times like this, I really need to remind us who we are. So right now, Africa is going through a very, very challenging time. And where is our challenge coming from? It's coming from us, human beings. Human beings in the sense of God created persons who all have, like they say, anything that has a beginning has an end. We all have a time slot allocated to us by our Creator. And I say that because none of us are going to be here on this earth forever. Look around you, look into history, all the great names you know and you knew or you read about or you actually met in person. Nobody stays here forever. And I feel our biggest mission as human beings is to contribute to the well-being of other human beings on this earth, being our community, contribute to our community, support you to grow, create a better world. And so we can all inherit this earth and make something good of it, so that when our time is done, we would have done our bit for the world. And then you find us in Africa. I mean, I'm going to go further into the kind of different things I come across, but the biggest one is we really don't want to be our brother's keepers. And that's why I say, for the greater good of Africa, what is going on in our minds that when you hear stories about people taking away billions of, not just Naira. Naira, when you look at Naira, the exchange rate, for instance, you're thinking, oh yeah, what does, if for pound, 500 and something, Naira becomes a pound sterling. So when you're looking at the equivalent in Naira, is a lot of money. But when you look at the hard currency, it is still not too much money. But when these people are taking money away from the system, they are taking billions of dollars and billions of pounds sterling. And so when you try to convert that into Naira, you don't even know how to count that anymore. And so they don't take it and say, okay, let's invest in the system. And so let's build houses, let's create roads, the usual thing you call infrastructure. Let's create community centers, let's create jobs. Let's look at agriculture and see what we can make of our own natural God-given stuff. You're looking at things like coconuts, you're looking at palm oil, you're looking at various types of herbs. And in multitudes, because if you live in the West where I do, when you walk into the shop, you look at how they have packaged everything you look at and you know that. And then you ask yourself, but I come from a place where these things are planted, sometimes like grass on the streets or the roadside. And look at how it's so beautifully packaged and I'm buying it for X amount. Could I not do the same thing where I come from? And so all we need is basic infrastructure to get us started. And so you live in a system where 24 hours of the day there is no official electricity. What do you get? People buy their generators and generate their own electricity to just basically be able to see. But someone has carted away billions of dollars to a different country or continent where these people are using that money to create jobs in their system. How do you explain that for a world that you do not own, that you're not going to live here forever? Things like this really do get to me.
So I did say one of our biggest missions on earth is to create good service for the community we live in and contribute to the welfare of our people, of people in that community. I mean, personally, I have done something in that direction. I started with hair, and I have helped so many women out there, thousands and if not millions, with our YouTube over 100,000 subscribers, people wanting to know more on how they can run their own hair business and, you know, gain that skill that can help them continue to grow their hair business. I know I contributed my bit to my community, being the community that is with hair. And further down there, I have looked at various ways of helping the natural hair grow. And so I'm looking at creating products that will help, you know, create softness with the afro hair and, you know, help the hair grow, which I've done with lots of models that has proved me right in that direction on how to care for your natural hair. So I'm doing things in that line. So it's not enough for me to just say it and not do it. I do it. And the other bit I'm looking at now is how to glamorize the African fashion, which you have seen me in various outfits and in various videos where I try to wear the African fashion, showing how glamorous it can be. Whenever I have to go out to any occasion, I dress very glamorously with my African fashion. I'm extremely proud of it. And so these are things I'm doing with the hope to create jobs, to create awareness, to help us start rethinking. There's a video I'm going to come up with that's going to be looking at how we have to, they call it programming, how we have to reprogram the way we think. Because as Africans, I genuinely believe that our way of thinking has been messed around with for centuries. And now it is time we have to reprogram the way we think, so we know that the power is in our hands to change our world, to change our continent, to change the society we live in, so we can create the service we're talking about. And I'm looking at how I can, with these new ideas I have towards the African continent, see how we can generate interest and glamour in the things we own. Because in the daily course of dealing with most people who come for my training, and most of us are Africans, and looking at how we can cope and survive in the Western world where we are, I am beginning to remind us that there's so much more in life that we can do, and not just continuously depending on other people who have thought of something. And then now all of us are hopping on the plane to chase these things that we think we cannot find. So my big focus with the Joyfido International, Joyfido Africa, is to educate and inform us about all the possibilities we have. And there's so much in food, there's so much in natural resources, there's so much sunshine here, and there's so much manpower. So we have so much possibilities to really, really change our future, to change who we are as a people, and then start looking forward to creating a better life for our generations and beyond. Now, what is really touching is the economic downturn that we have put ourselves into. And what I tend to say to people, again, it comes down to how exposed you are with life. And when we say exposure, or people like to call it education, it's not about just going to school and being taught by a teacher, and then you have theories to line or use when it suits you, because someone, to me again, education in that sense is all about programming. Because you see a child who can be creative at home and can think and wonder and goes to school and the teacher says, no, that is wrong. So they start telling you, this is wrong, this is wrong. And all they're trying for you is to fit in. If you've seen those images of sometimes when they draw circles and then they bring a square and they go, oh, you know, you can't fit into the pattern. So suddenly, because your way of thinking is a square and everybody else's way of thinking is a circle, you suddenly don't fit in. And then you become the bad person because you don't fit in. And then you hear people say things like, don't fit into the box. You need to come out of the box. The box is how the system has created a way of everybody thinking alike. And there's a movie I love so much, The Matrix. And if you watch The Matrix, you see the same thing. How? Because this person was thinking differently and everybody's looking the same direction, he became the bad person. So we need to come out of that box that we've been put into. And what differentiates you, the achiever, from the person who does not achieve is because you use your mind positively. You start putting ideas in there that actually is working towards something. Now we need to start aligning our mind to work, because as humans, we've all been created equally. And as a Christian, this is something that's really amazing. Go into the Bible and you see where in Genesis God said he created us all in his own image. And so when he did, he put all that information, all that message, all that knowledge into all of us. It's how we use it that makes the difference. And that's what's happened. We as Africans, we have allowed ourselves not to use our minds properly. And that's what's put us here. To the point now that we think what we have is not right until we go and get what somebody else has had, what somebody else has thought about and created. Think about it. For every physical thing you see on this earth, someone thought about it. And this is why I always say, did God make that thing? Because for as long as God has not created this package and this unique thing that you see that attracts you to want to run down to somebody else's, I mean, look at us as a race. We go to Europe, we go to US, we go to, you name it. And then Muslims, I ask myself, what are we looking for? What is chasing us away from where we come from? Because I'm sure when, yes, thousands of years ago, when this whole thing started, yes, you would say to me, we were taken as slaves and then we had to go and create those places. But so can we also use that knowledge that we used in creating those places to come and create our own. And so this is time for us to start thinking about what we need to do. And so if we can come out of this greedy state of ours and selfishness and all about just our family and what we care about, we could create a better Africa for the rest of the 1 billion people that live here. All of us could make a better, greater Africa without working with nature. Using the natural resources that's available. What stops those towers that we can see in US being built here, or even in China? What stops those towers being built in Lagos, in Port Harcourt, in Abuja, wherever, in other parts of Africa? We need to start thinking of how we can turn those pains that we are going through into possibilities and positivity, because this is where it really gets crazy. We are so concerned about challenges, about fear, about what if, what if, what if. Now, this is me. I took a plane. I've let my children. They're doing okay. But lots of people would not even leave their 20-year-old child in
England, for instance, and take a trip to think of what to do next in Africa, because I have a child. Now, what future are you creating for that child of yours if all you want that child to do is wake up tomorrow, have no job, and struggle?
So, we're looking at a scenario where we're not willing to challenge what's going on. We're all looking for that safe bet. We all want to go and hide and sit down somewhere quietly and wait for something to happen. And this is the part that really gets to me. What are we waiting for? Who are we waiting for? Today is the day for us to make that difference. Because if we're sitting down there and hoping, and I always remind myself, it starts with me. Let me create the future I want to see. Let me be the architect of that change that I'm looking for. Because we all want change, but no one wants to actually be the one that starts the change process. And it is something really, really serious here in Nigeria, because when we had the election going on and the government that's in power right now, their biggest slogan was change. And everyone was excited, we want change. But now is the chance to create that change, and none of us are creating change, because in as much as a typical Nigerian, we always look to the very first person, the president, we never ask ourselves, what about us? What can we do to create that change? And you see every position, that position of power, every person there wants to do something that's detrimental to the system. But we all want change. So where is this change going to start from? Because even when the man at the top, the president, decided to initiate changes, it still did not filter down to the last man in the country. And so the change comes down slowly and it hangs up somewhere, because further down from under, people have been so messed up in their way of looking at life that everyone thinks, you know what, this is for me and my family. But we're not thinking me and the community. And so what we've ended up creating is a system that's so messed up, everybody is worrying about their personal pockets and their personal gain, that no one's thinking about the generality of the community. And so in that vein, so people looting the system, and no one's creating employment in the system. Nobody's worried about what's happening to our youths. They are going to university, which is a big thing for us here in Nigeria. We love sending our children to school. And none of us are thinking of what they'll come back to do when they come back from school. So you all have, like lots of people love to call it, they call it educated illiterates. In the sense of, yes, you can read and write, but you can't think. Because if you cannot think, what makes you an educated person in the real sense of it? Education is not just about going to school to be programmed by someone and telling you this is how you fit into a box, but your ability to be creative. And to me, education starts with your ability to look at other people who made success in life, look at people who are actually adding value to the system. Taking on books and reading about how great people have actually got to that point of being great. I get people who say to me, this is my mentor, this is my model, and this is the person I like to be like. And I said, but have you bought a biography about that person? No. So how do you think that person got there? Because like there's a saying that if you want to hide something from the black person, put it in the book. We really do not like to read. So if we're not reading, how are we educating ourselves? How do we get to know how things would change for us for the better? And so this is a time for us to start reading our books, looking at things that help businesses to grow, looking at how we can create jobs, looking at how we can empower ourselves in the system. How do we use what's available to change something? I'm going to do a training on how to make creams to make our hair grow or soften our hair. I took up trainings on how to be creative with hair. I took up trainings on how to start making clothes and fashion. I'm taking training in so many uncountable things that I know that all I have to do now is put these things into action. But as usual,
sure the first thing you want to do whenever you want to create change is to be willing to sacrifice. And that's one thing we struggle with here in Africa or Nigeria. We do not like to sacrifice because we just want success now. Everybody wants to make it now. Nobody wants to put in an effort. And that's what they call sacrifice. Because even as a Christian, we know that everything in that Bible tells us of how people started from nothing. Even when Abraham, God was going to bless Abraham with everything. God said to Abraham, go and sacrifice your son for me. And we saw that that was the only child Abraham had. I mean, apart from the child from the concubine of the house of who eventually had a child for Abraham. The main wife, the child she had was just one child. But God said to Abraham, go and sacrifice that child for me to test his faith. And you go further down into the Bible to see how, before anyone, what about, is it Daniel in the lion's den? I mean, the story just goes on and on. How about Joseph? He started from nothing where he was dreaming, and then the brothers were so upset with him and they threw him into the pit. They wanted to kill him, and eventually they sold him off to these Egyptians, who then made him a servant. Before he became this person who then took over, and in the sense of providing and taking care of the needs of that community at the time. So you have to be willing to sacrifice. And when I am telling people, like when they come for training and I say, pay X amount of money for the training, people see it as they're enriching me. Okay, if in the process of sharing my knowledge I get enriched, thank God, because I've contributed, I've given you something, it's only fair to give me something back. But that's not even the direction I'm going, because most times it starts from you paying money for me to have the facilities that I give to you. My time, the accommodation you have to use, the electricity that goes in there, everything comes together for you to have the service you are going to get from me. But now, as a people, we just want everything for nothing. And I hear people say, but why do you have to charge for this course? Because I can go on YouTube and I can get all the knowledge I want. Okay, but you go on YouTube, you find that nobody goes on YouTube to give you everything there is. They can only give you snippets of something. So be willing, as a race, to invest into knowledge, invest into knowing, invest into getting as much as there is to help your own people come out of where we are. We need to wake up. So the truth is, like I've just said, we need to wake up to realities of life. We need to remind ourselves that for us to have change and to create a better continent that will be attractive and sought after by other people just like we go seeking. I mean, lots of people like to, we're going to seek greener pastures. And I find this really interesting. Really interesting, because we all get into that plane and run to these parts of the world. I am included, because I left as well 23 years ago. And I left typically out of ignorance and again out of curiosity. I wanted to see what the world had to offer. And at the time, out of necessity. And then it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. Because interestingly, I was reading an article in the newspaper or in a magazine coming on the flight back here. And the man was trying to explain what it is about us Africans when we run to other parts of the world. And I think the title was Be a Good African or something like that. And he was advising how when you do travel to Western world, you shouldn't have at the back of your mind to go and stay there and become, like some countries like to call you, illegal alien or whatever they want to call you. And so we go there and he says a good African will visit and come back home. And a very good point he mentioned was, we get on that plane and we go to this part of the world. But hear this, we go to a part of the world that's already developed. It's not lacking anything. It's not lacking manpower, it's not lacking technology, it's not lacking what to do to create a better society. And we hop in the plane and go there. So we're going there for what? Are we going to a place where people are looking for us to give us dignity, give us a sense of belonging? No, that's not what you're going to meet there. And I wish I read a comment like that years ago, probably would have made me think again. Because you're going to go and meet a system that's set, that's already been put in the right places, everything is in place, and so your role there is insignificant, absolutely insignificant. And this is what is happening to us, most of us Africans who have disappeared to various parts of the Western world. We go there with the aim to go and achieve greater, or we go with, I'm going to a greener pasture, and then you get there and you find that that's not what it is, because it's already set. Your input is no longer, it's not important at all. And so it now comes down to your survival, your ability to fit in and survive. And this is what I want to tell people who are still jumping and looking for every opportunity to run away. You need to start thinking again, because this is where the opportunity is. The opportunity is here in the sense of nothing has been set. Nothing has been set. It's not like a well-set community where you just come and then you wonder, where do I fit in? This system here now is open for everyone to come and contribute to it. So ideally, yes, we should expect that, okay, you know, let's say the government should put some basic infrastructures in place that will enable us to do our bit. But that's where we come in. We need to come and help create those scenarios. Unfortunately, from what we've seen over, for instance, how old is Nigeria? And look at the other African countries. We've all had this independence, we all had this ability to turn our countries around, but we haven't. And so it tells you and I that we are waiting for nothing. We're gonna wait, how did I say, hoping against hope. We have to find a way to get in and do something and contribute. That's what we have to do. So running away to other parts of the world to go and create something new, it's you're basically asking for the impossible. Because for someone like me who has never stopped walking, I don't see where it's going to end. You're in a system where the bills don't stop. The bills are constantly accumulating in every form. You might say to me, oh yeah, what do you expect? You have to pay bills. Yes, we have to pay bills, but sometimes it gets to a point where you start to wonder, is the system stacked up against me so that I could never survive? Is it stacked up against me such that I could not survive, in the sense of I did work so hard and I, you know, the typical way of surviving in the system, and I got the mortgage and I got a house, which is not your house, in the real sense of it, you pay all that money to the bank, and then the bank supports your money that you have invested, and then you buy a place and you say to yourself, I've got a house. But here in Africa, when you have a house, you have a house. You buy a piece of land. You cannot buy a piece of land in England or in the US, because the land belongs to the state. And then you just own that structure over it, because God forbid there's fire on that building. That's the end. That land is not yours. And so you buy this structure, you invest money in it, and then if for any reason you lose your job, your source of money coming in constantly every month disappears, that's you lost, because the bank is going to come and collect the property, it is theirs. And that's the things I went through. I bought a house and I lost it all because I lost my job, and I started my life all over again, and the bills were accumulating, and there is no end to it. And now, for those of us who did go there with the hope to create a better life for ourselves, or looking for these greener pastures, we found out that this green pasture is so distant from us. It is distant. I mean, I am here and I'm in Nigeria, and I'm chatting with people, and now they say, oh yeah, but then there's the electricity, and then there's the roads, and those are not the things you take to the bank, are they? Because you come back home and you see your friends, you see your peers, they all own 2, 3, 4 houses, and they still think they are not achieving, and they still want to complain and moan, and that's not what they raised to life. So if you are in that scenario when you got these things going, and you can do more by creating opportunities for other people to have a job, and because when they have a job, they help you to run a business that brings you money as well. When you're paying their salary, they're helping you run a business that brings you money. Everybody wins. So running away from a system like that because you want to go get constant electricity or a smooth road or constant running water does not answer it, as far as I know. And why would I know? Because I've lived in this system for 28 years before I went abroad to live another 23 years. So it's like, I know what I'm talking about.
Okay, so I know it cannot all be said in one video. So I'm gonna come to the end of this video. But this is gonna be a series of videos from me. Because like I said in the beginning, it's a feeling that's deep in my heart. And I just feel as a human, as a person, as someone who belongs to this system, it is only fair to, you know, discuss it, talk about it. There's something really interesting that came to my mind. I think it's in John, and it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Something like that. So I have grown to understand the value of words, the spoken word. You know, God started by saying, let's create man in our own image. And you may want to sit down and interpret that. Who else was with God when he said, let's create man in our image? But then the bigger message out of that is, we are God's creation in the replica of God. So where I go further down to really talk about this is, God created every part of the beginning of Genesis tells us God created, God created, God created. So if we are in God's image, if we are a replica of God, he gave us the power to create. That's a bigger message we need to get. He gave us the power to create. So for us not to be creating now, for us to be sitting down and waiting for somebody else to create for us to then go and enjoy, we are actually falling short of God's glory. Further down in Genesis chapter 2, it says, go and have dominion. Go and have power. Various Bibles put it in different form, but go and have dominion over everything that I've created, where we are the highest form of his creation, being in his image. So imagine the amount of power that you have in you as a person. He says, go and multiply the world. Because when you see, for instance, an apple, that's just an apple, but there's so much you can do with an apple. And so that's what multiplication means. Go and change whatever I have done, add more to it, put more value to it. And when you put in more value, what are you ending up doing? You're creating a job with being the person who's doing that, adding value. You're serving your community by creating something else that the community could use with that same thing. But us in Africa, what I find with us is we just leave God's creation the exact way he gave us. That's where we need to wake up. We need to realize that power he gave us to go here and multiply or go and create, being his replica, we haven't used it. There is so much facility, so much here in Africa that we can create a million times, so we can multiply a million times. I look at food alone when I walk into Marks and Spencer's and I see the amount of things that's done with various fruits and vegetables, and I think back home and I'm thinking, wow, look at what we could do too if we can see beyond our eyes. I was saying to somebody, you know, Paul and Saul, remember when he changed from Saul to Paul and the scales fell off his eyes? That's what's wrong with us. We need to constantly pray to God to, you know, take away that
blindness and release our spirituality for us to see beyond what we're seeing now. All we see around us is lack. All we see around us is poverty and pain and sadness and how government has not done that, But we're forgetting that we have a greater power. We have the greater power to go and multiply everything that is within our reach, everything that God created. It's all down to us to use our brain to start thinking what we could possibly do. I remember there was a time we had in Nigeria, they used to call it abamid. Things, the people in Abamid were making things. They were using their mind to create amazing things, and physically you could see a slipper that was bought from there, and then you see the Abamid version, you go, oh, this one is cheaper because it's abamid. Yes, but they were doing something amazing because that's the same thing China did. Now we all, everything you buy now is made in China. Somebody started that. Why did we not continue the ABBA version of things that could have by now spread to the point that we would have made things better? I say to everybody, start no matter how small, just start. Because as you start, it gets better. So, words. In the beginning was the word. And God said, you keep hearing in the Bible, God said. God speaks to us and our mind comprehends. That's when you hear faith. Because you believe, you know that thing you've heard, you could turn around in your mind and it could create something new for you. That's where I want us to be. I want us to be able to look at the Bible as Christians and use it to our greater good. Because we're up here in Africa, most of us are Christians. And yet we sleep in the church 7 days of the week. That's a different topic for another day. Because seriously, we need to wake up and use God to our greater good. He wants the very best for us. But we're not doing what he wants us to do. Rather, we're crying to him every day. And we're allowing people to use us to do that. While the same people who claim to be helping us are the same ones using us to go and fly jets across the world, and they tell us they are believing in God. We need to wake up and do what God wants from us. We need to use his words, and we need to act on it, and we need to create a better society for ourselves and for our children and for generations of Africans to come. Thank you so much for watching this video, and I know it's quite intense and it's exciting, but I am as excited as you are to be receiving these messages that's coming to me. Let's start using our head, use our mind, use every great thing that God has given us to create a better life for ourselves and everyone around us. And I hope to see you in the next video. So thank you so much, and God bless you.